I listen extremely carefully, and you use the word deity once, and earlier you used the word gift when speaking about experience and consciousness. I'm curious about your views on God.
I think about a year or a bit over a year ago, I started reading books on consciousness, which has made me sort of think about these things a bit. I would say I'm agnostic. I do think, though, now that there is something incredibly amazing about the universe. It is all the sights and sounds and the colors and the things. I don't have it to hand, but there's a W.B. Yeats hated, like William Blake, hated Newton and science because Yeats said something along the lines, Newton took away everything, all the sights and sounds, and left us just the excrement of the world. But Bishop Berkeley, the idealist, so Bishop Berkeley said, there are only souls or minds, and God implants ideas in these minds. And an interesting thing is, I did actually get round to checking the etymology of idea.
Uh-huh.
Any idea what it is?
No, no idea.
It comes, it's the Greek word for a pattern, a shape. So going back to what Lucretius was saying, and the ancient atomists, they wanted to have a theory of shapes. So I think mathematics defines the shape, the shapes, starting with a triangle, but going up to any tetrahedron, any complicated shape you like. And then somehow or other, consciousness for us gives us the gift of seeing all these things, hearing, and so forth. Now, whether this makes me more inclined to believe in some sort of divinity, I don't know. I did now start checking out the etymology of divine. And this comes from Sanskrit. It's also related to sky. The island of sky in the northwest of Scotland and the sky we see, that's all tied in. I guess it's our idea of wonder, where we just look at the stars in the sky. And so I think it's Sanskrit word deva for a god, these sort of things there. But I mean, who am I to say? All I can say is it's pretty damn wonderful. That's all I will say with confidence.
Oh yeah.
But I do like the idea that I'm getting more and more confident about this idea that mathematics just creates that structure. And there couldn't even just be points in space. I mean, particles gives you some idea that they're a bit like tiny billiard balls or something, but they might just be purely mathematical points. By the way, it's interesting that the Newtonian n-body problem, the word body there is just a historical leftover. So when Newton formulated the first law of motion, he said any body continues in a state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line unless it's acted on by force. But then explicitly the great mathematicians who followed him, Leonard Euler and Lagrange in the 18th century, when they were the real creators of the modern n-body problem, it is actually point particles. So what I like about point particles is that they have no size. So the only quantities that come in are the separations between the particles, and then you make it scale invariant by dividing by that root mean square length, the average. So, and then you get pure numbers. So really, that's what the first great sound dynamical theory is about. It's about just points. So I'm now coming, but I mean, I have to be honest, these ideas, some of these ideas have only come to me in the last day or two, that you asked about the perihelion advance. Maybe we should look much more seriously at the role that the instruments that we use to make these observations are playing. Think about, I've already talked about the two-slit experiment. I mean, it's unbelievable, the tiniest little thing in the most special environment. But then think about radio telescopes or these incredible ones at 5,000 meters in the Atacama Desert in northern Chile. I mean, these are very, very special structures. Is it possible that we think that the experiments are just discovering what is out there, but could it be that to some extent they're playing a significant role in creating what is observed? I've already made this point with the two-slit experiment, that they're forcing. The two-slit experiment means that we will only look at a very, very special part of a shape. That's required. So maybe all these marvelous instruments, telescopes, all of them, electron microscopes, are playing a significant role in creating what is observed. And I come back to what Eddington said, you know, we have found a strange footprint, and lo, it is our own.
Well, there are some interpretations of quantum mechanics that have the experimenter as the creator of the results. There's the Wheeler interpretation. Kurt here, quick aside, I actually cover the top 10 most common interpretations of quantum mechanics on my Substack, explaining them all extremely intuitively. There are a variety of other topics on my Substack as well, such as what it means to explore ill-defined concepts, why, quote, explain like I'm five, else you don't understand, end quote, is a foolish idea, and what God has to do with ambiguity. The website curtjaimungal.org redirects to that Substack, or you could just search my name and Substack. It's free, so check it out, as there are also full-length podcast episodes released ahead of time there.
Yes, there is something along those lines, you're right. I don't know.
I want to tell you, since you're such a fan of etymology, do you know the etymology of pattern, since you mentioned
pattern?
That?
But wait a minute, I said idea, the etymology of idea was patterned, wasn't it? Yes, now what's the etymology of pattern?
The etymology of pattern is father, so it's paternal. And then do you know the etymology of matter?
That's bulk or a mass, just a bulk, isn't it?
It's mother. Matter eventually comes from mother.
Oh, that's very good.
So what's super interesting is that you can think of this world, speaking of speculative ideas, as the merging of, you need a father, you need a mother, you need pattern, you need matter, and that gives rise to this world, the child. Hmm. And maybe that has something to do with the threeness of, many religions have a concept of triality.
Oh, yes, no, these are very... I may also say, just talk, as we've gone into etymology, the N-body specialist at the observatory in Paris, who's been such a help to me, Alain Albuy, when I was talking about etymology, he suddenly turned to me and said, "What's the etymology of etymology?" But very good points, Kurt. Yes, no, these are very interesting. Also very interesting is What is the etymology of chaos? Do you know that one?
I believe it comes from Greek and it starts with a K and not a CH, and it has something to do with gaps or the difference between a boundary and what bounded the boundary or what gave rise to the boundary, something like that.
Yes, you're quite right. So first of all, our modern meaning of chaos is not from the ancient Greeks. It's from Ovid, very much later. So when you go back to Hesiod, it is it's much more akin to chasm, where there's a gap between matter, a chasm, but it's also our yawn, the gap between...
Yawning, like breathing.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. No, well, not so much breathing, but just that the space between two. So this is, there was a very interesting talk about Hesiod and the etymology of chaos that I heard a year or so ago.
Like a yawning chasm. I get it. Okay.
Yeah. And I did comment that this is exactly what the n-body problem is about, because you have a space between particles, between matter. But it is very interesting, I agree. Certainly the father and mother is certainly very interesting.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey Kurt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.